Like consciousness, free will is often misunderstood because we know it by reference, but it's difficult to know it by content, what we really mean by free will. A lot of people will immediately feel that free will is related to whether the universe is deterministic or probabilistic. And while physics has some ideas about that, which change every now and then, it's not part of our experience, and I don't think it makes a difference if the universe forces you randomly to do things or deterministically. The important thing seems to me that in free will, you are responsible for your actions, and responsibility is a social interface. For instance, if I am told that if I do X, I go to prison, and this changes my decision to whether or not to do X, I'm obviously responsible for my decision because it was an appeal to my responsibility in some sense. Or likewise, if I do a certain thing that it causes harm to other people and I don't want that harm to happen, that influences my decision. This is a discursive decision making that I would call it's a free will decision. Will is the representation that my nervous system at any level of its functioning has raised a motive to an intention. It has committed to a particular kind of goal. And it gets integrated into the story of myself, this protocol that I experience as myself in this world. And that was what I experience as will, as a will decision. And this decision is free in as much as this decision can be influenced by discourse. So to me, free will is a social notion. It means that this interface of social interaction, of discourse, of thinking about things, about this interface of knowledge, language, conceptual thought, is relevant for that decision. If you have a decision in which it doesn't play a role, for instance, because you are addicted to something and you cannot stop doing it, even if you want to, then this decision, I would say, is not free. I grew up in Eastern Germany. It was communist Eastern Germany, and it was a very weird ideological country. A country that believed in stories about how the world works that I, as a nerd, thought are obviously not quite true. I had difficulty believing the official stories about how the world works. It was like some weird kind of religion. And then the wall came down and it didn't surprise me in the least. And then we entered a new dream, a new shared model of the world. It was not quite true. And I realized that most people now fall for this new model. It was very interesting to see this for me. And if you look, for instance, at the US, the majority of US Americans do not believe in the theory of evolution despite all the evidence to the contrary. The majority of people are on this planet are religious, even though there doesn't seem to be very good evidence for a multitude of creator gods and so on, in my view at least. And if it existed, if a creator god existed, it would be very hard for me to understand why this creator god really does care about whether I worship it or all these things that we attribute to creator gods by religion. So it's very hard for me in some sense to intuitively understand why humans are religious and why humans are ideological. But I think now, over the years, that this is not a bug, it's a feature. Humans are a programmable species. Religions and ideologies are operating systems for societies. And they have been so throughout most of our history. And this idea that we can build society based on rational arguments is very, very recent and very novel. And it's not entirely clear if it really works. But it's clear that we cannot really build societies on conflicting ideologies that are at war with each other. In the past, this has led to situations where the ideologies solved the problems by killing the unbelievers. Or the religions did the same thing. And we all agree this is not what we want to have. We want to have an open society, a pluralistic society, a non-violent, tolerant society, but still one where people work together and cooperate well. And this ability to wake up into a shared dream in which people believe things because their neighbors believe them has been a very powerful feature that's probably the reason why we were able to build large-scale societies. We have to understand that when people cooperate, they're very often in what we call a prisoner's dilemma, a situation in where, in order to achieve the greatest good, you have to give up something for yourself. Even in a situation where that is in some sense a bit irrational. Because if everybody else is not doing it, you're going to be worse off. And for these prisoner's dilemmas, we have various solutions. The easiest solution is to have a reputation system. You basically keep track of who did what when, and you make sure that only the good guys get cookies in the future. And the problem is that these reputation systems do not scale. If you have too many people in your tribe or in your family or in your village, you just lose track of who did what when, and you cannot really synchronize it by talking about it. So after a couple hundred individuals, a reputation system doesn't work very well. It also doesn't really work if you are not looking. So if nobody is doing the surveillance, how do you make sure that nobody is defecting and stealing stuff from the fridge of your tribe? Right? So what do? We evolve the ability to be normative, the ability or the need to be good. And this need to be good, this need to follow internalized norms, this need to serve sacred principles, is something that is probably a feature that is ingrained into our genetic makeup. And of course, this alone would not be good enough, because goodness is like an arbitrary vector in value space. People also have a need to synchronize what's good. So people will try to feel what's good in their in-group. It works via empathy. Empathy is the primary mode in which we transmit norms. If we dress up somebody as an authority, as a priest, as a professor, as a pop star, as a politician, and this person says a certain thing with conviction, and people see that others believe it, they start believing it themselves. And it's obviously very useful to do this. There's almost never a situation where it's useful to have an opinion that is different from the opinion of your boss. So this is the ability that we got, and it means that people perform the same things, that they follow the same rules, regardless of the size of the group. And this makes it possible to build agricultural societies with hundreds of thousands of individuals, and then millions of individuals. It makes it possible that this agricultural society has people that specialize on different fruits and different traits and different materials and different crafts and so on, and produce all the multitude of tasks and tools that we need to get an agricultural society to run and be able to outcompete the nomadic societies. And I think the reason why Homo sapiens is the only hominid species that's left is because we outcompeted them all. We were in the same competitive niche, and we were a species that was programmable, that was able to coordinate arbitrary large group of individuals. That was very powerful. It just turns out that this mode of tribal organization is not sufficient for the world that we live in now.